Okay, then I'm going to bring to order the regularly scheduled meeting of the Simsbury Planning Commission. Today is Tuesday, May 11th, 2021. All who can, please rise and join me in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance,
to the flag of the United States of America. And to the Republic for which it stands,
one nation
under God,
indivisible,
with liberty and justice for all.
And thank you for imagining a flag. I realized as soon as I stood up, I forgot to share it. But the thought is there. Okay, good. Let's move on to the roll call then. If you are here, please signify by saying here. Holly Bem?
Here.
David Bloomy?
Here.
Aaron Levitt Smith?
Here.
Craig McCormack is otherwise occupied and absent tonight. Alan Needham?
Here.
William Rice? I'm here. Rich Cortez?
Here.
And Julie Eaton?
Here.
Okay, we have one empty spot. So Julie, in our alternating fashion, I'd ask that you be seated tonight as a full voting member of the commission.
Sounds good.
Thank you. Okay, so we have minutes that have been presented to us, minutes of the April 27th, 2021 Planning Commission meeting. As is our tradition, Alan, could you lead us through that?
Sure. Okay, page one, which are we not numbering the lines?
Oh, I don't have numbers on them this time either.
No. Okay. Well, page one, the old-fashioned way. Call to order, roll call, anything?
Yeah, on number two, I think it should be member, not members.
Okay.
Where it says appointment of alternates.
Right. So under section two, roll call number one, appointment of alternates, Richard Cortez promoted to full voting member, singular. Okay. Also another editorial item I'll point out, section three, second bullet, Ms. Levitt-Smith, there are two periods after Ms. You just remove one of those.
I wanted to ask a clarifying question for Alan and Bill. In the middle of that paragraph, section three, it said to change the wording to reflect that Mr. Needham and Chairman Rice stated the proposed bills would completely cause a revision or would not cause a revision.
I think we could say could cause, because that hasn't passed, that legislation. So that, I don't think, well, does it say, wait a minute now. What's the answer?
Right in the middle.
Yeah, I know.
See what I mean?
I thought that was not what you guys were saying, completely caught, but I don't know. So I'm just asking.
I thought when we were talking about that, the initial minutes talked about an elimination of the POCB, and this was a correction to say not eliminate, but revise. But I like the should be could.
Yeah, I think could is because it hasn't passed. So if passed, then it could be modified before it's passed. So
yeah, it could cause a revision. Could. Okay.
Yep. All right. So the notation that's in.
Okay, that's fine.
The minutes that we're looking at is, I think, an accurate representation of at least what I wrote down.
Okay.
Where I crossed out the word eliminate and put in cause a revision of.
Okay.
So Chairman Rice, Mr. Neum explained, Ms. Levitt said these bills would completely cause a revision of the POCD. So that's what I had for the revision. I think that's what's written down here.
It is. I just didn't. That's not what I remember. I wasn't sure. So I'm just pointing out, was that the intent?
Okay. It's okay to say would, because it's prior to that, it talks about a proposed
right
bill. So it's okay to use the word Would.
I think it's okay.
Perfect.
Anything else, page one?
Not for me, Alan.
Flipping the page to page two.
So, on the second line, it should be plank, the first word, Plank Hill Road, not Plan Hill.
I have that.
It says plank.
The second sentence, first word, yeah, it should just be plank.
I also see Plan Hill. Yeah, so there should be Plank Hill. Mm-hmm. You see it, Alan?
The second line?
Well, I have it on the last line on page one.
Oh,
oh, that's okay, what's going see? On.
Yeah, okay.
And I have it on the first line on page two.
Yeah, I have another second line.
That's why we invite you, Julie.
Well, good thing I got seated today.
Okay. All right. Yes, I do see it.
We had that happen before where people had it, our numbers weren't lining up.
Yeah.
Sorry about that, Alan.
I see something about halfway down. How can I explain it? Let's see. It has to do with the spelling of the word Lou.
Oh, I had that one too.
So I think there's a couple, at least three locations where I'd like the spelling of Lou. As right now it's L-E-U. I believe it should be spelled L-I-E-U.
Yeah.
So Amanda, if you could just do a spell check on that or a word search and change the three. And I think that first occurrence, which is in the about halfway down the page for me, the following line says in lieu for open space, and for should be of.
Of. Yeah, right. Yeah, it's just pretty
much. So other than the comment about the word lieu and of, that's all I have for that page.
Yeah, me too.
That it? Final page.
So I have a bullet above the word motion. It starts with Mr. McCormack made a motion to approve. The last line, Connecticut General Statute 826H, with no need for open space for monies in lieu of open space. So the word open space or term open space should be added there. Everybody follow that?
Yeah. And again, Lou.
Yeah.
Another Lou. Yeah.
And I have a comment under five correspondence.
The last bullet under that, should it be Firetown instead of Freetown? For me, it's the last word on the page.
Yeah, it should be.
Okay.
Okay, that one's not jumping out at me, but I take your word for it, Julie. Oh, yeah, there it
is. It's Mr. McCormack's bullet.
Yeah, Freetown should be Firetown. Good. Can I go on to five?
Yeah, you're allowed now, Bill.
Okay, so it currently reads, there will be one more application coming to this commission. However, Mr. Glidden expects an appeal. So
yeah.
I think it was referenced to the 8-30G Affordable Housing Appeals Act. Right, Mike? Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, my comment is to strike an appeal and add it to be 8-30G Affordable Housing Appeals Act. That's all I have. Is there Alan, you want to call a motion?
Yeah, okay, I can make the motion. I move that we approve the minutes as amended for April 27th, 2021.
I second.
You can call a vote, Alan, if you'd like.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That's it.
Any abstention?
Abstentions. Yeah.
Mr. Bloomy abstains. No harm there. Okay. Motion carries. Thanks, Alan. Okay. So, Mike, I believe at this point I'm going to open the public hearing, right? Okay. So, I will open the public hearing regarding application number 21-03 of the town of Simsbury, owner, for the resubdivision of a portion of a property located at the rear of 133 Holcomb Street, Assessor's Map G09, Block 202, Lot 011. So, Mike, you as the applicant, maybe you can just give us a little background on this application.
Yeah, so a lot of members should be familiar with this parcel. I'm just going to screen share a quick map for you. Let me just get this going here. Everyone can see the map right now?
Aye.
Yeah.
Well, I see a picture. Oops. So behind this is 133 Holcomb Street, where my mouse is moving around right here.
Yep.
And as you recall, this property owner, Stephen Antonio, approached the town about purchasing a portion of the open space which is located to the east of his property. So this was referred to you by the Board of Selectmen pursuant to 824 because it's a sales of property, which this commission found consistent with the plan of conservation development in a 5-1 vote. It went through a public hearing process with the Board of Selectmen. The last step, and it's actually, we are under contract to sell this to Stephen, is because we're modifying an approved subdivisions map of open space, it triggers a technically under statutes, a re-subdivision approval by this commission. So what he's under contract to buy is 8/10 of an acre, which is basically the area behind his house here. And I can pull up the map. There's a map from, it was Anchor Engineering, they changed their name, that prepared an A2 survey of the property. Only other thing is that as part of this deal with the Board of Selectmen, during the public hearing process, the Conservation Commission was concerned about impacts after the property owner were to purchase this property from the town of any sort of building within this area. So as part of our deal with them, that there will be a conservation easement over this area to prohibit any construction or building within the area that's to be combined with 133.
That's any new construction?
Any new construction, that's correct.
So anything that's there now is acceptable?
It's going to remain. At least that wasn't part of our concern with the discussions of this land transfer.
Okay.
I know it's not part of this application, but I just have to, kind of just like how we were obligated to mention this, this was related to a separate land transaction involving easement for the bikeway over and off Terrifield Road of the old well property. So there's several moving parts that are still, we're ironing out the other portions of that with this action. But what you are only hearing tonight is this, what you've already kind of gotten a picture from us. It's just the last step of finalizing the transaction, which has been approved by the Board of Selectmen.
Okay.
How did
you
determine the cost?
So Stephen actually engaged the services of a appraiser and did an appraisal of the area and determined, we're selling it for, or 52. He's purchasing it for $6,000 was the total value, but that price was based on an acre originally, and that was adjusted to the actual area. So that's why you'll see a different number. And I think I attached the sales the sales agreement from the Board of Selectmen.
So I was a little confused. What's the 52,000 then?
The 50, the well, it's 5,200 would be 8/10 of an acre. What he's purchasing.
So 6,000
was what an entire acre was worth. So they adjusted it because we originally thought it was about an acre, but as we started, as Jeff Shea sort of started analyzing the area, we determined it was not an acre. It was more 8/10 of an acre. And then the surveyor confirmed it when we did our survey. So he's under contract to purchase 8/10 of an acre, and that price of $5,200 is reflective of the area that he's purchasing based on the appraisal. I didn't attach the appraisal to this application just because it's, you know, we're not negotiating price with him at this point.
Okay, but
Aaron, I think the $52,000 is the payment for the easement at on Terrafill Road.
So the town is going to pay him $52,000 for that easement. Is that what it is?
That's what it looks like.
So he's paying us $6,000.
Yeah, I'm not sure that that's pertinent with this application, though.
Well, it was in our stuff. I mean, so I was confused. I was confused by the numbers. So, Michael, I guess I'm a little confused. I'm hard-pressed to think that an acre of land is only worth $6,000?
No.
Well, it's landlocked, can't be used for anything.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Also, I think the prices paid and the deal between the town and Mr. Antonio is not really part of our discussion. It's like, is there, I mean, they performed a legislative function, what they paid, when they pay it, what the deal is not,
is no, not that's the
under the purview of our group. So,
right, the first segment did, I was just confused about
their deal.
Yeah, but I was confused by the numbers. So I just wanted to be sure that I had the numbers straight in my head.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for clarifying.
Okay, good. Yeah, better to get it cleared up, Aaron.
Right. Well, because I didn't understand the numbers and all of it. Like, we were getting all of this information. So I was like, okay, well, I just want to be sure I understand it correctly.
Yeah.
So since this is a public hearing, I'd like to give members of the public the opportunity to make comments or ask questions. Or are there any members of the public with us?
Nor did my office receive any written comments prior to noon today regarding this application.
Okay. All right, then. With no input from the public, I move to close the public hearing. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay. I'm sorry, who to Alan? Was that Alan? Mm-hmm. Okay. Any discussion on the motion to close the public hearing? Okay. All in favor of closing the public hearing, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Say nay. Any abstentions? Motion carries unanimously. The public hearing is closed. Okay, let's move on to old business. Our old business is actually taking up the action related to the application that we just discussed. So, commissioners, we still have an opportunity to discuss and ask questions. Well, I guess we can't ask any more questions, right, Mike? The public hearing's closed.
So you can ask questions of staff, but I would add just hopefully it's related to the documents that I provided you. I can't go beyond what's in the documents.
Okay. Commissioners, any comments, questions? Okay, so Mike was kind enough to propose some language. So if someone would like, if we're in agreement, this I'm referring to attachment A from staff letter dated May 9th, 2021 to the Planning Commission. Everyone familiar with what I'm referring to?
No, I didn't see that. I have the Dropbox open. I don't see that.
It's on the second page of the staff report for Holcomb. Staff report, Holcomb subdivision.
Do you have it open, Holly?
Yeah.
Could you share your screen?
I see it.
Oh, I got it. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't have it on the PC. That's
okay.
I could get it.
Would someone like to make a motion? And I would suggest just read what's been drafted.
Or you can refer to just attachment A.
I'm sorry, I don't see the draft. What are you referring to, Bill?
Okay,
the statement.
It's in the staff report.
I know, but I'm not understanding the comment that Bill is at. So I just want to be sure. What is the comment that I'm not sure I'm understanding. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. So staff wrote a letter, okay, dated yesterday, addressed to our commission.
No, but it's the wording. Forget it.
No. What's the concern, Holly? I mean, Aaron.
Nothing. Just go. I'm not following along with you're saying read it off. I don't see what the wording. So just maybe somebody can read it so I'm understanding what wording we're trying to do. I'm not following along with this process at all.
Oh, I guess what
I'm
I was trying
to
sure say.
I'm not quite sure why I'm not, but I'm.
Yeah, I guess the point I'm trying to make is that there are two conditions that we're considering to go with the approval. And I wanted to make sure that those two conditions are included in the motion.
And what are those two conditions?
Oh,
maybe,
Michael,
can you tell us maybe what are the two conditions? Yeah. Maybe, and I'll try to open it back up.
So the first is that a Mylar be prepared to be filed on land records signed by the chairman. The second is that a deed restriction is required prohibiting development within the area that's formerly an open space as pursuant to the Board of Selectmen's decision.
Hey, Mike, would we need to add the portion about keeping the zoning the same? I believe I read that. You don't have to put that in the
zoning. The zoning clarification will not change. And then
I know, really, but do we need to state that in the approval that the zoning will not change?
It's not your
will stay residential. Okay.
You don't have that. You don't have that authority.
Gotcha. Gotcha. That makes sense.
Mike, have that? That attachment up on the screen just a minute ago?
Yeah, I just did. Do you want me to put it back
Aaron,
on?
Why don't you look at what he shows you?
Yeah, I guess you guys, I'm sorry that I'm not following, because usually I get this, but I'm reading because I'm doing two screens so I can look at both. But so we're really approving this application with the caveat that a Mylar be prepared and went to the Board of Selectmen.
Correct.
Okay.
Well, those are the two conditions.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Then.
Yeah. It just took me a little while. I'm just having some senior moments.
Okay. So then I'm going to make a motion to approve application number 21-03 of the town of Simsbury. Owner for the re-subdivision of a portion of a property located at the rear of 133 Holcomb Street, Assessor's Map G09, Block 202, Lot 011. Re-subdivision approval is subject to the following conditions. Number one, Mylar is to be prepared for signature by chairman and filed with the office of the town clerk. And two, pursuant to decision of the Board of Selectmen, a deed restriction that no structures or development within the area to be combined with 133 Hot Meadow Street. So, that's not right. It should be Holcomb Street.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Oh, very good. Good catch.
I'm testing you, Bill.
No problem. Okay, motion made. Is there a second?
I second.
Holly Bem, thank you. Any discussion on the motion to approve the application with the two conditions? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion, please signify your concurrence by saying aye. Aye.
Aye.
Any opposition, please say nay. Any abstentions? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. All right, Mike, so I'll be waiting for a call to come down and sign the Mylars.
Okay.
Okay, very good. That brings us to new business. Mike, I see per the agenda, there are no new applications.
Nothing yet.
Okay. Any no referrals, obviously, was not in our packet. Any general commission business such as correspondence?
So one thing I just want to bring to the commission's attention, because you're going to be the first commission to hear this. The governor's order for remote meetings is set to expire May 20th. We are hearing rumors that may be extended to June 20th. However, should that order be expire May 20th, we are looking at ways to hold in-person meetings with the commission and have it sort of hybrid where the public can call in to the meetings. Stay tuned. I will have more information because your next meeting, you'll be one of the first commissions that may have a hybrid meeting or some other a different form should we move out of the remote world for mm-hmm. meetings. And if we do go to in-person meetings, most likely we're going to choose to use a larger space. So my guess is we're going to be using the library in one of the programming rooms. Yeah. So just as a heads up to this commission.
So we'll try to maintain the 6 feet between.
Yeah, that's years. Our difficulty right now is, especially for the larger land use bodies, is finding an area where we can get all if nine members show up.
Yeah.
How can you fit nine people on a table, spread them 6 feet apart so not everyone's on top of each other? The main meeting room will not work for that.
Right. That's tight.
In that setting.
Yeah.
Isn't everyone vaccinated by now on the commissions? I mean, do we?
But the rules are the rules.
Yeah. Yeah. So we'll stay tuned. You know, like I said, you may find out all of a sudden next meeting we're in person.
Yeah, that thought crossed my mind today. I'm like, oh boy, I better look at the invitation again, make sure it's still a Zoom meeting.
So what I'll do is that let's just say we have a meeting in 2 weeks and it's not remote and it's in person. You'll probably get multiple emails from me to remind you that we're in person and we're meeting and where are we meeting? So everyone knows. And then, you know, we'll try to circle back. If the governor's order is extended to June 20th, which is a rumor I'm hearing from a few of my friends in Hartford, it means that we're going to come up with a plan on how to go back to in-person. However, we're going to have a little more breathing time to implement that.
Okay.
And the only thing I'd ask of the commission is that most likely because we're going to be either the first or second group that may be in-person hybrid, there'll be some technical hiccups that we're probably going to have to muddle through.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
So that's my biggest thing. I know it's not correspondence, but, you know, it was discussed last night at the Board of Selectmen meeting, and I just wanted to share it with this group.
Yeah, thanks, Mike. Personally, I think our remote meetings have been very productive. The technology has held up well. I would not object to, you know, doing it until the hybrid model technology is proven. I'd rather not be the guinea pig for that.
Yeah. Do we have the option? Can the commission decide to stay virtual?
So that's one thing that there's a difference opinions at FOI. What I've been told at FOI through one person is that as soon as that executive order expires, you have to be in person. Cool. And I've heard another person say there's nothing prohibiting you from calling in or doing this via Zoom. So I guess my warning is that we're still, this is going to be an evolving situation. And, you know, with Bill, if everyone agrees with Bill, you know, I'll kind of take that comment back to the powers that be and say, listen, you know, one of my land use commissions would prefer to stay remote until we know that the setup is known and that the bugs are worked out. So they're not the first group that deals with that headache.
I'm usually, you know, on the bleeding edge of this stuff, but I don't know, for some reason it doesn't feel right.
Well, and the mask order is still in place too. So if we are in person, we're wearing a mask inside, which will have its challenges as well, being 6 feet apart. So,
yeah.
Yeah, good point, Julie.
So,
okay, interesting.
But like I said, I just wanted to keep this conversation going with the board, so you're aware of it.
Okay. Anything else, Mike?
Nothing new to report. But I guess we'll maybe after the meeting, Bill, we could talk about the 24th.
Okay. Yeah. Sure. All right, commissioners. Any comments? Anything else before we adjourn?
Yeah, where are we? Where is it with the approval of the affordable housing plan? Was that finalized? Has it been approved? Is it?
Well, it's funny. That's what Mike wants to talk about with me. I guess we're gonna have a presentation to the Board of Selectmen. Do they ultimately approve it, Mike? I think that was my understanding.
I mean, technically it's done. I mean, commission approved it. So
yeah.
They can endorse it similar to the POC, but it was brought to my attention that once we completed it, we're done.
Does it need to be submitted to the state or anything like that?
OPM, that it's going to go to OPM next. Okay. And then, you know, we're basically going to be one of those communities that we've completed our affordable housing plan pursuant to 830J, and we'll be on the clock then in 5 years to update. So the hope is that now the Board of Selectmen may take a interest in the subject, because there's a lot of public interest in it, and say, sure, maybe we dive deeper into the subject and we have 5 years to complete that dive.
Okay.
I guess they didn't make a task force, but they made like a subcommittee of the Spirit Council. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah. So yes, there's a subcommittee on housing at the Spirit Council, which, I can't remember from their packet, but they were given a mission statement last night, educating the public, promoting housing, I want to say, but don't quote me on that. But it wasn't the task force that the plan calls for.
Right. So I know some people had reached out to me that they were concerned, and I said, well, it was a recommendation we made, but it's really up to the Board of Selectmen.
Mm-hmm.
So... yeah.
Is there a reason why they didn't want to do a task force?
Well, I don't know if they didn't want. I think this opportunity came up. I don't think it precludes a task force, does it, Mike? I mean, it might still.
No, that still can happen. And the other thing, too, is remember, we wrapped up our affordable housing plan just as they jumped into budget.
Mm-hmm.
So
they're busy.
So they were a little preoccupied. There was a few things going on in the budget cycle that I think drew their interest. So now we're out of budget, and now we step into the main stage again to say, here's the brand new plan. And then, you know, that may spark the interest to say, maybe we need that task force that's cited in the plan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I didn't see the two as mutually exclusive. But anyway. All right. Well, good luck with that, Bill. Are you going to present that?
I believe so. I think that's what Mike and I are going to talk about
right after
this.
Yeah.
All right. So you can let us know next meeting.
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. Well, good luck.
Thanks.
It'll be our second presentation, right, Bill?
Yeah, that's right.
We did it to EDC already.
Yeah.
How did that go?
You know, I thought it was, I think it opened the eyes of some of those committee members. You know, I guess I have to be careful because we're so close to it and so intimate with the ins and outs. People who are just, you know, like maybe familiar with it, I think they're surprised that, you know, what it's really about, and also the content and effort that we put into it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was very well received. Answered a lot of questions. You know, people are still hung up on the term affordable.
Yeah.
I think that will be, forever, right?
Well, I mean, they're hung up on the term because most people think they know what that word means.
Right.
This piece of legislation completely abuses the term.
I mean, well, you know, it's, I guess, you know, there's no definition written in stone. You know, what's affordable to you may not be affordable to me.
That being said,
it's a subjective
term. Most people think affordable means a price range, so that if a quarter of all your homes are in that price range, then a quarter of your homes are affordable. I mean, that's...
That might be one way to look at it.
Yeah, I think that's the way most people look at it.
Not the legislators.
Yeah.
Okay, good then. Can I entertain a motion to adjourn? Someone make that motion, please.
I move we adjourn.
Thank you, Alan.
Second.
Dave Bloomy, thank you for seconding. Any discussion on adjournment? All in favor of adjourning, please say aye.
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 Any opposed, say nay. Any abstentions? Motion passes unanimously.